Here's a story of seven drivers whose racing skills mean many for their teams. Each of them desires to be their country's champion. Yes, they all have dreams. Here's a story of famous racetracks that was running some races of his own. Every year it crowns a champion in the springtime. Yes, many call it home. There came one day when these drivers met this racetrack, and they knew that it was much more than a hunch, that this group was somehow race at Indy. That's the way they all became the Brazilian Bunch. Brazilian Bunch. Brazilian Bunch. That's the way they became the Brazilian Bunch.
Two members of the Brazilian Bunch have qualified for the 79th running of the Indianapolis 500, and the rest will have their chance, along with Uncle Emo, as pole day qualifying continues here on ESPN. Look at the weather conditions. 77 degrees. Yesterday it was 25 degrees cooler. The wind was blowing 20 miles an hour stronger. The humidity was about 30% higher as a heavy mist hung in the air. But qualifying got underway for the greatest race in the world. Hello again, everyone. I'm Bob Varsha, along with Derek Daly. Just hours after a dramatic Formula One Grand Prix in Spain, we're ready for more drama here at the world's greatest racetrack. Yesterday, in what's becoming a tradition on pole day, Derek, Mother Nature turned the promise of great speed into greater frustration.
Yes, indeed it did. In fact, all this week, we've actually been treated to some of the most remarkable happenings ever seen here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. All this week, the weather forecasters were absolutely wrong. They forecasted rain early in the week. It didn't come. In fact, we had the most perfect weather for speed, and we got it. Team Menard, with Ari Leyendijk in particular, did lap speeds almost 235 miles an hour. So yesterday, of course, we expected to break Roberto Guerrero's track record. It didn't happen. It rained. Then we had another remarkable day, because at the end of the day, we saw IndyCars qualifying almost in the dark, in weather conditions with air so dense and so heavy and so moist, it was virtually raining. On the way down the front straight here, people used flashes from their cameras to try and take pictures of their heroes. At the end of the day, we did get 11 cars qualified. Team Menard are on the front row, provisionally on the pole. I say provisionally because there are people here. There's a Honda here who may be able to knock off those boys from the pole, or at least get onto the front row. But the field is wide open.
No question about it. We'll show you everything that happened yesterday. But the important thing now is what's going to happen today in these remarkably different conditions. One of the guys who has a chance is standing by with the first of our three pit reporters, Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thanks a lot, Bob. You know, there are about 24 cars yet to run today that have a shot at the pole or the front row. And among that group, eight are over 230 miles per hour, which will be good enough for the front row. But the fastest of that bunch, as you mentioned, I'm standing with 35-year-old Canadian driver Scott Goodyear. And Scott, your practice speed's 232.2. That's quicker than right now Scott Brayton's pole speed. The question is, can you duplicate it today? And if so, that would mean a front row start.
Well, it certainly would, and that's what we'd like to see. The Honda power plant has worked well, and the Firestone tires I'm delighted with, but it all plays down to weather. We saw cold, blustery conditions yesterday, but good for speeds, for tire temperatures, maybe not so, but overall, I think the speeds were quick, and it's getting maybe a little bit too hot today. We're third from the end. We'll be on the track probably 2 to 3 o'clock, so we're working with the chassis right now to make sure we don't get caught out.
Well, weather a concern. The Honda engine awfully strong here today, but about weather, who better to talk about it than a former driver himself? Here's John Bikas.
Well, Jerry, one of the things that people ask is, it's a beautiful sunny day today, why would speeds be down? Well, when the temperatures come up here at Indianapolis, two things happen. As the air temperature rises, it becomes less dense. Therefore, the engines make less horsepower. They go slower down these straightaways. The second factor is, as the heat and the sun shines here on the racetrack, this is made out of asphalt. One of the components of asphalt is oil. So therefore, as it gets hotter, the oil actually comes up out of the asphalt, therefore making it more slippery in the turn. So two reasons why the speeds come down when it heats up. Heat here is certainly the culprit for taking away speed at Indianapolis. Let's now check in with Gary Gerald.
Well, Jan, we're here at the head of the qualifying line where it picks up from yesterday. Now, remember, all of these people, until the line is broken, have an opportunity yet to run for the pole. We don't think that they're going to be able to challenge the temporary pole speed set by Scott Brayton because of these weather conditions that you've been talking to. At the moment, at the head of this qualifying line, the number 33 car of Teo Fabi. Teo has been one of those drivers that Jerry mentioned, over 231 miles per hour during the week leading up to qualifying, and in fact, in the practice session just concluded a half hour ago, the fastest of the lot at 228.6. So you can see how the conditions are impacting the speeds they've dropped off. Now, yesterday, in that gloom that Derek was talking about, the track temperature right around 90 to 92 degrees. At the end of the practice session, less than a half hour ago, Goodyear tells us the track temperature was 117 degrees, and it is going up. You can feel the heat building here almost by the minute. It's going to dramatically impact how these cars handle in our qualifying runs. But Teo Fabi is the man of the moment. He will be our first qualifier. Let's go back up to the booth.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. No question the tension down there in the pit lane will grow as the temperature rises higher. Now, one of the great stories this weekend, unless you happen to be standing in their garage, is Team Penske, the most successful team in the history of this great race, with the defending champion Al Unser Jr. almost 10 miles an hour slow. What's going on?
And a team, Bob, that has more resources available to them than anybody else in the pit lane here. Yet they have struggled every single day. They are almost 10 miles an hour off the pace, which is unheard of from a team that won this race 10 times. Now, on Friday, we saw some remarkable footage from Emerson Fittipaldi as he was out trying to squeeze some speed from this car. Just have a look as he comes off turn four. Look behind the car and the black streak. See the black streak there being laid down by Emerson's rear tire? Now have a look as we continue the video. You can see the black streak continues, then he goes back across the road. I have never experienced tire scrub like that from any car ever here at the Speedway, and it just goes to show that aerodynamic grip is not enough to make these Penskes handle. They've also tried to squeeze some extra mechanical grip out of it in what must be a very unusual way.
Well, Al Unser Jr. is having the same problems. The car's virtually identically set up. Jan Beekes can perhaps tell us more about the Penske situation.
Bob, we had an opportunity to check in with Team Penske, and it turns out that what they're trying to do is they're trying to settle the car down. You see, they have a lack of grip through the corners, overall aerodynamic grip. So one of the tricks that you do, you put a little more toe in on those rear wheels. That's what left that big black streak down the straight here. Now, you saw a little different streak between Emerson Fittipaldi and between Al Unser Jr. That's because there's a little different camber. As you change the camber, the width of that streak will change. Now, that may have worked last year with their 209-inch Mercedes-Benz because they had a horsepower advantage. It doesn't really work because when you see that black stripe now, obviously it's scrubs off the speed of these Penske machines. Now, let's look today and see if we see any black strips, because I'll tell you what, if you're going to get the car free enough to make the field, I don't think you can lay down that kind of rubber.
No question about it. Remember, Al Unser Jr. won this race from pole a year ago. If he qualifies well back in the field, should make for a pretty interesting race come Memorial Day.
I think something else we should remember, Roger Penske has no experience and notes to draw upon from last season, because the car they had here last year was very different. They had probably 1,000 horsepower in the car that we all know didn't handle very well, didn't go through the corners very fast. So he has the same bad handling car here, but he doesn't have the horsepower to make up the deficiency.
Indeed. Now, we talked about the missing records, the records that we thought were going to broken. Don't be fooled. There is still great joy down in the Team Menard garage. And for more on that, let's go down to Dr. Jerry Punch.
And rightfully so, Bob. They are still smiling down here at Team Menard. And, of course, we are out on the line, actually, with the man who sits on the pole right now, provisionally, we should say. But, Scotty, I don't know if you got much to worry about the fact that the temperatures have changed so drastically today.
Well, that's always the, you know, $10 million question is, what are the conditions going to be here in Indianapolis? And yesterday, the wind down the front straightaway was as rough a wind as I've ever felt coming down the straightaway, but it was cooler temperatures, and the car just really performed well. Today, it's a little bit hotter. I was out in this car earlier, the Quaker State backup car of mine, and Buddy Lazier will be driving it later today, but the conditions were good this morning, and I don't know. I ran a 26 with it, and I don't know. I was just shaking it down for Buddy, but I don't think anybody's going to be able to run a 31.6 average. But we're going to see. You know, there's a lot of fast guys behind us, and qualifying's filled with surprises.
Were you disappointed in the fact that even though you'd been over 234 a couple of times yourself and your partner, Lion Dyke, the fact that you only ran 231 in qualifying and averaged 231.6, was that a little bit of a surprise to you, or did you feel the weather was dictating that?
Well, I think it's a real easy thing for people to say only 231.
And I got still pretty quick.
It was a lot more difficult 231 than that 234. So I was thrilled to death to get it behind me. But I think that certainly there's disappointment that you couldn't capture the track record. But I would have to tell you that after a week like Team Menard has had, you know, if I would have scripted it out, you know, I could have left out the track record and been happy with what we did. I think that naturally you want to have it. And naturally, I'm a former track record holder here. I mean, I've held the one lap record here and would, you know, love to have it behind me today. But, hey, it wasn't in the cards. I'm just thrilled with what we did.
I think your run was thrilling, but I think the biggest thrill I had was seeing Larry Curry and John Menard imitate Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders jumping up and down and trying to somersault over here when you came by. Let me ask you quickly, Buddy Lazier in this car, is there a shot he could put this car on the outside of row one and have a Menard sweep?
Well, I think that's a lot of pressure on Buddy. Buddy hasn't been in the car. He's going to get some time later today. I don't know if they're going to roll him... If they roll him out at, you know, right in line with the heat of the day, it's going to be hard on him to do that because he just doesn't have the feel for the car yet. Now, I would sooner think that they may, you know, pass and then let him come back out, run some, and get comfortable with the car and then be a second-day qualifier. But I don't really know. I don't make those decisions. I'm just here to support the team and, you know, do anything I can do to assist.
Scott Brayton watching and waiting right now. He sits on the provisional pole with an average at 231.6, and very shortly we're going to take a look at his qualifying run from yesterday.
Yes, indeed we will. Thank you, Jerry. And keep in mind, with Mario Andretti's retirement last year, the man you just heard from, Scott Brayton, is the most experienced driver in this field with 13 Indy 500 starts in his record book. We'll be back with more live from the continuation of pole qualifying here at Indianapolis. Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, here's a look at the qualifying order as we expect them to come out today. Eddie Cheever already with a car in the field. Johnny Parsons there. Teo Fabi, we've already seen in line, a real threat for the pole. Stefan Johansson waved off yesterday.
And of course, we have to remember, although this is the second day, everybody you see now is considered a first day qualifier. There are some unusual rules here at Indianapolis, and we'll try and go through them as the afternoon goes on here. But the first man that takes his car through the tech line, if he does not take an attempt at qualifying, he is no longer considered a first day qualifier, which means whatever speed he does, even if he beats Scott Brayton's time, he will not be able to start with the front day qualifying people. He will have to start behind them.
There you see, end of day one qualifiers. At that point, we expect a free-for-all as teams try desperately to get their cars into the show and not have to wait another week to next Saturday and Sunday for days three and four of qualifying.
Look at the names there. Scott Sharp, he is in A.J. Foyt's backup car. So Eddie Cheever is safely in the field, and A.J. Foyt has decided to put in another young American, Scott Sharp.
While the fans continue to head for their seats, let's take a look at what happened yesterday, beginning with our provisional pole qualifier, Scott Brayton.
They have had a remarkable week here. The most colorful cars at Indianapolis. Every day they sat on top of the timing sheets, setting track records as they went. But as Scott told you earlier on, you're in the lap of the gods when the weather plays tricks. But this was a remarkable run by Scott Brayton because he was out to beat his teammate. As we watched the run, it looked so clean, but he said earlier it was very hard work, harder to do 231 than it was to do 234 earlier in the week.
Of course, pictures and sounds can't give you any indication of the conditions at the time. This was late in the afternoon. Basically 90 minutes of qualifying, during which 17 cars were presented and 11 qualified. and the cars seem to get quicker over the four laps, which I would assume means that heat is slow getting into the tires.
That's right. You will look at the side of this car and you see a most unusual engine cover, a big pregnant bulge on the back of these Menard V6s. Well, this pregnant beauty delivered yesterday, because we are watching what may have been the pole run. Look at Brayton go right out of the black groove, almost into the gray. This was the Buick V6. John Menard took over the complete engine program. There's John on the left-hand side. And team manager Larry Curry, John on the radio to his man, tells him exactly what's going on. But Brayton didn't know till he crossed the finish line whether he had beaten Ari Leyendijk, who at this time was the fastest.
Scott Brayton say a few moments ago that it was a lot harder to make this run averaging about 231 miles an hour than it was to go 234 in good conditions in practice.
This team have done their homework. They came here with a well-engineered car. It is a Lola. However, they had their own gearbox designed, made from magnesium, not from aluminium. Therefore, it was about 14 pounds lighter. They then took the differential or the spool out and made a lightweight spool. Also made it lighter weight, because the old V6, the stock block V6, has a big old heavy lump in the back of these cars. They don't handle that well if there's too much weight at the back. So engineering wise, they also did their homework.
Through the short chute, finishing up his four-lap run, averaging 231.604 miles an hour, not a record. And afterwards, he was asked his feelings about falling short of Roberto Guerrero's mark.
You know, it was a very difficult day to break it, and I said that it was going to come down to conditions. I mean, Ari ran a phenomenal lap yesterday with the 234.9, but conditions were ideal. When you get in this kind of wind, it just slows you down. You can't get the momentum that it takes to be up there, and I'm just thrilled to death to be here. The team's done a great job, and, you know, that time's up there. If anybody can go get her, they deserve her.
Making up for the disappointment of missing out on pole back in 1985 by 0.2 seconds, Scott Brayton. And this is the run that he overcame to take that provisional pole.
And when Ari Leyendijk took to the racetrack, he was the unofficial track record holder, because on Friday he uncorked a lap of 234.9 miles an hour, almost 235. And the ease with which these two Menard cars seem to find that type of speed was absolutely remarkable. And Ari Leyendijk has been one of the most popular and the most sought after drivers here every single day, hounded by photographers, by television crews, trying to get a comment on how fast these cars can go, because people began to talk about 236 miles an hour. Maybe Ari baited them a little bit, because he was the first one to mention a speed that high. Quite remarkable.
Last year, when the Penske's dominated with the 209 Mercedes engines, there was talk of sandbagging, that the cars had a lot more in them than Al Unser and Emerson Fittipaldi showed. You get a similar feeling with regard to the Menard twins?
Absolutely not. The reason why? Leyendijk and Brayton were out to beat each other. Each of them wanted to go away with the unofficial track record. And they knew when the conditions changed from poor to worse, that the lap record, which is held by Roberto Guerrero above 232 miles an hour, was not possible. But you see Leyendijk at 230.847. Believe it or not, Scott Brayton only beat Leyendijk by a tenth of a second per lap. You or I could never measure a tenth of a second, but that is all Leyendijk came up short by.
We should also credit the fans, more than 50,000 strong, who stayed here from before 11 o'clock in the morning, when qualifying was scheduled to begin, to late in the afternoon, when this was among the first runs they saw.
How confident were they of getting their cars on the front row? Well, consider this. Seldom has a team gone into a qualifying session with such power packed into their punch. On Friday evening, John Menard had four cars in the top five speeds for the day. Never seen before here at the Speedway.
Ari Leyendijk. Dijk, who admits openly that he would rather run with a full season team rather than a one-off here at Indianapolis. But he'll take this kind of an opportunity when it comes up. One of the earliest qualifiers in yesterday's abbreviated run for the pole. We asked him afterwards whether the record was on his mind as he made his four-lap run.
I'm not really worried about the record. I don't really care about the record. I'm just worried about how fast the other guys are going to go because, you know, tomorrow conditions could be a lot better for them and they'll go faster. So that's what I'm really worried about.
And now here is our third fastest provisional qualifier. Just like Brayton and Leyendijk, Michael Andretti, though he was third fastest yesterday, could be bumped today.
And look how gray and gloomy the day is now when Michael ran yesterday. This was the time of day when you could almost put your hand out and feel the moisture. Gray, almost a fog, descended over the speedway. And yet Michael went out and did a very impressive 229 mile an hour opening lap. Now, he had been over 233 with this car, a Ford engine car, earlier in practice. However, he will tell you, up and down the back straight, he got a tow from his teammate, Paul Tracy. Paul Tracy wasn't that impressed later on when he wanted a tow from Michael because Michael didn't oblige.
It's been a very difficult year for Michael Andretti thus far. A lot of crashes, a lot of folks questioning his motivation, whether he's driving the car too hard. When you come to a place like Indianapolis Motor Speedway, you have to be very, very precise, and perhaps no one knows that better than Michael Andretti.
That's right. Early in the week, he said he already conceded the pole to the two John Menard cars, but he said he was going to shoot for the front row, which he did manage to attain. This is a Lola. It's an all Lola front row, but this is the first of what we would call the normal engines. This is the same engine as Michael uses weekend in, weekend out on the IndyCar World Series. And the engines in John Menard's car are specific and specialized just for this one particular event, the greatest racing event in the world.
If the form of the last week of practice holds, Michael Andretti will be on the outside of the front row, and I guess we will call him best in class.
Best in class, only in race one. He's only interested in race two, which happens in 2 weekends' time. Carl Haas owns this team. He is the distributor of Lola cars to anybody who wants to give him a check for about $475,000. And they actually go and do their own separate engine development, mechanical development, and aero development program up in Chicago. So this car often sprouts their own development pieces that very often other teams covet.
Down to the line, Michael Andretti, who would probably give up the rest of his IndyCar season to win his first Indy 500.
And something most unusual, his dad Mario spent the whole run watching in civvies, not out there in his driving uniform for the first time ever.
Everybody knows about the Andretti family fortunes here at Indianapolis, and that was the obvious question for Michael when he got out.
I tell you, I've always had a lot of tough luck here, and this is as good as a pole for us at the moment because, you know, we knew we didn't have a shot at pole, but we were hoping for front row, and hopefully it will hold up.
Well, that remains to be seen. Here's a look at the front row, the provisional front row. Scott Brayton could still lose this pole. I don't think we could say that enough. His average 231.604 miles an hour. Ari Leyendijk slots into the middle of the front row, and Michael Andretti on the outside. We have plenty more still to come. A track inspection is going on at the moment. We anticipate another run for the pole soon.
Of 231.
Welcome back live to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where pole day qualifying has extended into day two of qualifications for the Indianapolis 500. Bob Varsha and Derek Daly with you. Yesterday's intermittent rain showers took their toll. We had at least one major incident involving the fastest rookie in Indy qualification history. Gary Gerald is standing by with him.
Well, Bob, that rookie is Andre Ribeiro. He's one of those boys from Brazil, and I know that it had been a terrific week. Two cars at better than 230 miles per hour, and then the problem that erupted in practice yesterday. Let's first of all start with how you feel physically after getting your first taste of Indianapolis concrete.
Well, I feel very good. Unfortunately, we have this incident yesterday, but I'm okay, no problems, just damage on the car. So I'm ready for this.
Was it at all difficult to get back into the car and put that out of your mind as you went out to practice this morning?
Well, it's always a little bit difficult, but you have to concentrate. There is another job to be done here, and then forget. Go for it.
Now, the conditions have changed so dramatically. We've been talking about that since we've come on the air, Andre. How do they feel differently to you from what you've experienced through the week and particularly yesterday?
Well, it definitely is completely different. The weather today is completely different than the weather when we test here before, when we practice here. So it's a little bit of a gamble, but I think we'll be fine.
Do you have a speed in mind that you'll accept to get into this field?
No, I'm really not trying to think about the numbers. I'm just trying to think what I have to do there to be as quick as I can.
I know it'll be a great thrill once you're a member of the Select 33 here at Indianapolis. We wish you well.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Andre Ribeiro.
Ribeiro, in fact, is number six in line to go and qualify. When you hit a wall that hard at that speed, it does sap a bit of confidence from a driver. And the only thing that gives you that confidence back is when you get back into the car and it immediately feels comfortable. You trust the car. You know what it's going to do. It's not going to do something unusual. Then your confidence suddenly shoots back up again. Also, when you're about in your mid-20s, you tend to not worry about hitting things too hard sometimes.
You do heal a whole lot faster. The pictures tell it all. We have absolutely beautiful conditions today. Maybe not conditions for top speed, but great conditions for the drama still to come. Stay with us. Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where the track is open for qualification, an engine has fired, and former Indianapolis pole sitter Teo Fabi pulls toward the racetrack.
And those of you with a keen eye for numbers will realize that number 33 was the same number that he came here with in 1983 when he became a rookie pole position man.
An astonishing performance driving for Jerry Forsyth.
Brand new team set up here in Indianapolis. He was a partner to Barry Green and Forsyth Green Racing last year, elected to go his own way, form his own new team, and they are having a very, very good season indeed. Running at the front most of the time, hasn't quite got the results that that team probably deserves. Probably one of the best presented teams in IndyCar racing. One of the most remarkable things about this team is the engineer. Robin Hurd, remember that name? One of the designers, in fact, one of the owners of March Engineering when they came here with the March IndyCar. Robin Hurd has now been an engineer for Teo Fabi, who must be his favorite racing driver. He engineered him in Formula 3, Formula 2 back in the 70s, World Sports Cars, Can-Am Championship, and in IndyCar. And Teo Fabi was a winner in every one of those categories, including IndyCar.
And they are an interesting couple. Jan Beekes has more on Teo Fabi.
Keep in mind that Teo Fabi ran a 2:28 earlier today, but that was with a track temperature of 98 degrees. As we heard Gary say earlier, it now is at 117 degrees, nearly 20 degree difference. We'll have to see how much that cuts the speed for Teo Fabi.
Coming around to take the flag. Interesting couple. Robin Hurd is well over 6 feet tall. Teo Fabi well under 6 feet. Fabi as taciturn as you will ever find an Italian, while Robin Hurd is as outgoing as you will ever find an Englishman.
All the way to the wall, keeps about 3 feet from there. Momentum is such a key. When you take the green flag, you have to have a head of steam coming off turn four. You see the marks on the walls where people hit yesterday? The Indianapolis Motor Speedway don't leave them there very long. They go out and repaint the walls. So Teo Fabi finishes one lap. As we wait for the time to pop up, is it fast enough? Oh, 226.75 miles an hour. So right now, it is only quick enough to get him in the middle of row two. He will have to pick it up from here.
Be interesting to see if the cars speed up or slow down, given the diametrically opposite weather conditions and track conditions that we have today.
Through the short chute again. Off turn four. This is where the driver looks down, sees the revs, he's pulling off turn four, and he knows before he ever goes across the start-finish line whether that lap is faster or slower. They always tell by the speed of the engine, not the speed of the car. 226.3, not good.
And he was right out to the wall with those white right side wheels. He does it again. Teo Fabi using every inch of the racetrack. Gary Gerald has more from the pits.
We talked with Neil Mickelright and also Tony Brunetti with this team. Said, what will you take, guys? They say, we know the speeds are coming down. If we got something over 226, we'll take it. That's the temporary plan coming in.
Well, Gary, you can't see it from there, but Teo Fabi almost kissed the wall twice on that last lap. So whether he's beginning to experience handling difficulties, we don't know. Waiting for the third lap speed to come. Oh, he's in trouble. He's slowing down. He's now down to 225.3. So team manager Tony Brunetti has to make a decision now whether he will take this speed or wave him off with a yellow flag. Remember, Tony Brunetti will time Fabi coming off turn four, not at the start-finish line. Then he'll make the decision in about 1.5 seconds whether he'll take it or send Fabi to the end of the line for a second chance.
It appears Fabi will take the checkered flag, and that will probably put him, unless he's speeded up, no, 225.191, his slowest of the four laps. His official average, 225.911, will put him on the inside of row three.
And I'm sure they will consider that a very safe speed. Last year, when qualifying was over, the difference between the pole position lap speed and the last man on the grid was about 7 miles an hour. That's the usual good rule of thumb. So if that's the point, if that's the case, then Teo Fabi should be reasonably safe.
Now, you know, that has sent team engineers and drivers and mechanics scurrying to their cars, scurrying back to the garages and gasoline alley, wondering what tweaks they can put into their cars to gain that last ounce of speed. Eliseo Salazar,
better known as Greasy Old Salad Bar, all the way from Chile, continuing this international flavor.
Familiar to ESPN fans from his forays in IMSA World Sports Car Racing with the Ferrari effort of Giampiero Moretti.
And believe it or not, he was my teammate in March Formula One back in 1981. Eliseo Salazar, big hero in his native Chile, has his own television show. It's the Chilean equivalency of America's Home Movies. So it's obviously Chile's funniest home video.
Now, because Salazar is on the track, that means Stefan Johansson pulled out of line. He waved off one qualifying effort yesterday in his primary car.
Salazar's fastest lap of the week so far, 227.2. Which is actually reasonably impressive for a rookie here at the Speedway. Dick Simon tends to this car. Dick Simon puts the setup on it, gets information from his teammates, Davy Jones being one of his teammates, Carlos Guerrero from Mexico being the other, who was remarkable here on Friday. He did a 229.
Dick Simon has reset the record for oldest man to turn a wheel in practice for the Indianapolis 500. Took Davy Jones's car out on the opening day at age 61, having been out of an Indy car since 1988. The Dick Simon garage has been an interesting place. Dean Hall in and out of the car. Davy Jones not here. He was out racing in Winston Cup on the first weekend. Lynn St. James into Hall's car, then out again. Terrell Palmroth in and out of the garage. It's been a real revolving door at Simon Racing.
He's in trouble here. 222.7. Certain that Dick Simon will tell him to back off here. He may do two or three more laps just to get the experience of qualifying under pressure here, but Dick Simon, the team manager and team owner there, is a very worried man. He has the decision whether to wave this off. Remember, every car has three opportunities to qualify. He will monitor this lap, second flying lap. Probably will be faster because that's a very slow opening speed. No, it's even slower. Dick Simon will wave this off. Has to. Way too risky. He's down into the 221 mile an hour range. Way too risky, but leave him out there. Let him get experience.
Now, you mentioned the three qualifying attempts. It is the car that qualifies and not the driver. So a driver may make six or more, depending on how many cars are available to him.
And the driver can jump into a qualified car that he hasn't even run, which we saw Scott Goodyear do back in 1992 when he went from the back of the grid to almost win the Indy 500. And Dick Simon waves the yellow flag. Not unexpected. He knows there's more speed in that car. It was down to 220.8, so go back and scratch the head. Gary Gerald down there trying to get a word with Dick to see what happened. And Ribeiro gets lined up to come out.
Jan Beekes is down there at the head of the line.
Just to give you a quick update of what's taking place here, we saw Allinger Jr.'s spare car get rolled through tech. That was the 1T. They're not expected to run that car. Now we have Roberto Guerrero's car. Roberto is standing just to my right. He does plan to make an attempt in the number 21.
All right, before he takes to the racetrack, we'll take a quick timeout and return for more live coverage of the Run for the Pole at Indianapolis.
Attempt? Yeah, must be.
Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, Bob Varsha, Derek Daly, Jerry Punch, Jan Beekes, Gary Gerald. We're all here to watch qualifications for the pole continuing on day two. And here is the man who had that big crash yesterday, the fastest rookie in the history of Indianapolis practice, Andre Ribeiro. Jan Beekes has more on his situation.
Talking about the track temperatures, we know how the 117 degree track temperature affects the Goodyear tires. Remember, Andre Ribeiro is out there on Firestones, and talking to Al Speier, director of racing for Firestone, he says, hey, we did all our testing at about that temperature. We actually like it when it's hotter. We'll see how much this car slows down. Maybe these temperatures will be better for Firestone cars.
Don't you know, you'll know exactly how Firestone and Goodyear did relevant to one another in the newspapers tomorrow when pole qualifying is finished.
Andre Ribeiro about to face the most pressure-packed qualifying situation he has ever faced in his career as a racing driver. He is a graduate of the Firestone Indy Lights series, and he graduated with this team. Steve Horn from Tasman Motorsports did 2 years in the Indy Lights series, won the championship in both years, and then brought this young man along with him to graduate to IndyCars. What a package this has turned out to be. The Honda power plant, some people think maybe the most powerful engine in IndyCar racing right now, the most powerful normal engine, I'll qualify that statement, as opposed to the Menard V6. And with the Firestone tires, this has been quite remarkable. It was such a surprise when Scott Goodyear did a 232 miles an hour earlier in the week. A surprise to everybody, I think, except Scott Goodyear. He maintained that sly grin look on his face as if he knew what this package was capable of.
His car owner, Andre Ribeiro's car owner, that is standing by with Gary Gerald.
Steve Horn, and right now he's watching his car come up behind us out of turn four, and he'll be headed for the straightaway. And as he goes by us, he hits the watch. What do you look? Oh, 227 on this watch. You got to be happy with that.
Very happy. Andre's done a great job for us all month. Had a tough time yesterday, and see what this turns out, but we're really pleased with what Honda and Firestone have done for us this month.
Were there apprehensions or concerns after the incident yesterday, Steve?
I don't think so. I think we understood what happened. My big apprehensions right now, these are very, very difficult conditions because it's so hot and we haven't run on this before, but let's see what we can do right now.
Okay, good luck to you.
Thank you.
Well, he can do very well right now. The first lap, 227.192 miles an hour.
Oh, great opening lap. You could hear the emotion in Steve Horn's voice because he rides along virtually with Andre Ribeiro, and his second lap about to pop up, and it's even faster. It is even faster, 227.6. So Ribeiro is halfway through the pressure-packed situation of qualifying for the biggest race in the world, and he has had Brazilian TV crews hound him every single day here because they report on his every move back in Brazil on a daily basis.
His average at this moment would put him on the outside of row two.
And he's using car number two. definitely reduced. Car number one to kit form yesterday with that autograph against the concrete wall, which probably is the biggest bang he's ever experienced in his career. Oh, he drops down, way, way down. 224.467 miles an hour for Andre Ribeiro. He must have had a big moment.
His average right now, 226.426. That would keep him on the outside of row two. But there may be something amiss. He's reported leaving rubber streaks off the corners as well. The Reynard chassis, distinctive with those drooping front aerodynamic planes.
And he takes the checkered flag, so whatever that last lap was, which is way back up, in fact, that was his fastest lap, 226.7 on that last lap, giving him an average of 226.495. Solidly in the field, he will be absolutely delighted with himself.
And he will nail down the outside of row two for the moment, dropping Eddie Cheever back to the inside of row three. Teo Fabi goes to the middle of row three, and Paul Tracy to the outside. There you see his four laps.
I'll guarantee you his heart is absolutely pounding out of his chest, because sometimes you hold your breath, and something happened there in lap three that caused Andre Ribeiro to hold his breath. Here's the next man to hold his breath, the current track record holder, Roberto Guerrero, who only does the Indianapolis 500 these days, doesn't have a full-time drive. He should take some consolation out of that, though, because the two front runners of the moment, Brayton and Lyondike, are also unemployed racing drivers, so to speak.
Guerrero has had such an up-and-down career. Of course, we don't need to go through the problems when he sat on the pole that year and the car snapped off the racetrack before he ever took the green flag.
And of course, Guerrero almost lost his life in a testing crash here at Indianapolis back in 1987. He was testing, came off turn one, and something broke on the car, pitched him into the wall. He was hit very hard and suffered head injuries, laid in a coma for 19 days. Eventually came out of it, made a remarkable recovery, came back to racing, and has not enjoyed the success that he had before he had his accident. But look at the debris on this racetrack.
Rather large plastic bag that could get sucked into a radiator inlet, ruin your whole day. Perhaps no driver has spent as many laps at such a great speed as Roberto Guerrero. Might be interesting to compare him with the likes of Rick Mears and some of the other great qualifiers here at Indy. Mears, of course, the all-time pole-winningest driver at Indianapolis Motor Speedway with six. Just to see who has the fastest career average.
Roberto is in a Reynard chassis. Adrian Reynard owns that company, new to IndyCar racing last year, came here with a started off continuing his remarkable record as a car constructor, winning his first race ever in this series, as he did in Formula 3 and Formula 3000. So Adrian Reynard building very fast racing cars again for IndyCar. This is last year's car, a 94 car. The time he set the record, he was in a Lola with a V6 Buick engine run by Kenny Bernstein.
First lap, 225.603 miles per hour. That's funny, anywhere else in the world we'd be talking lap times, but here at Indianapolis, the only thing that matters is how fast you went.
It's all about speed. And what does speed mean? People begin to get a bit blasé here in Indy when they read the newspaper to see 225, 227, 228. If you just consider for a second that an Indy car covers the full length of a football field every single second, if he's just doing a warm-up speed of 200 miles an hour, gives you an idea of the velocity of these machines on this front straight here. Straightaway speeds have been no more than 243 miles an hour on average, although the fastest this year, which was in a tow, was Ari Lyondike, who went down the back straight at a 248 miles an hour speed. That's almost 250.
that is astonishing. I mean, those are the kind of speeds we're used to seeing on the old Mulsanne straightaway at Le Mans with full-bodied cars. For an open-wheeled car with relatively poor aerodynamics compared with the full-bodied machines at a place like Le Mans, that is a staggering speed.
Three laps for Guerrero. He's picking the pace up, 2:26 for his second lap, and he goes even faster because lap three is 227.1. So Guerrero is safely and solidly in this field as long as he completes another 2 miles. Down the back straight, 238 miles an hour this car has done down this back straight. They try to go flat through turn three. It's very bumpy. They go all the way to the wall. There's a big bump on the turn into turn four. Then you let it go all the way to the wall. And then you hope for every horse that's behind you to kick and scream and give you all the power you can. His fourth lap, was it faster? Oh, it wasn't. It was a little bit slower, 226.1. But he is absolutely solid and safe in the field at 226.4.
Inside of row three, just a tick slower than Andre Ribeiro, Roberto Guerrero is into another Indy 500. Let's learn more about what the drivers think of these conditions. Jan Bikas in the pit lane.
One of the guys who's pretty confident that he'll be safely in the field is Robbie Gordon. Robbie, yesterday you were pretty confident you'd have a shot at the pole, but with these temperatures, do you think it's realistic to go for the front?
I don't think so. You know, we went out this morning in practice, and we had a hard time running 228 miles an hour, where yesterday we were running 230.6 pretty easy. It's unfortunate because we did have a shot at least a front row spot. Now I think we're looking at second or third row.
So is it you just now being consistent? Is it going to be hard for you to get up to a speed that you'll accept? You know already what you'll take and what you won't?
Oh, yeah, we'll take a 225. You know, the most important thing is to get in the show, and hopefully we're up in the front three rows and we'll concentrate on the race.
I just talked to your engineer, and he says, actually, in these conditions, you have to add wing to it. Have you guys run in these kind of temperatures to know how much to add to it?
Yeah, we did. The biggest thing right now is there's a lot of wind. Last week or early in the week we ran a 229 at 83 degrees, and that's about what it is right now, so maybe we can.
Well, we'll certainly look for it. You probably stand on it and try for the pole just for the heck of it, huh?
We're gonna give it what we can, but I know there's not a 231 in the car.
Thanks.
When Robbie Gordon talks about standing on it, he knows whereof he speaks. Now, here is a guy who will be fun to watch, Raul Boisel, one of the better oval track qualifiers in IndyCar.
Quite spectacular, particularly on oval tracks. Another graduate from the Formula One ranks, now lives in Miami. Mercedes-Benz engine, teammate now to Bobby Rahal. Familiar color scheme. This was a color scheme carried by the Dick Simon cars last year, and Boisel then moved to Bobby Rahal. 230 miles an hour, just above that, has been his fastest time of the week so far. So I was curious to see or to hear Robbie Gordon say they'd take over 225. Obviously, they think anything above 225 is absolutely safe and sound in this field. I can only imagine that Boisel, in this condition, or in these conditions, must be thinking the same thing. Anything above 225 or 226, they'll take.
Well, the outside of row three is Teo Fabi at 225.911. So that would put you on row three.
Oh, Boisel is in trouble here, boys. Raul Boisel is in trouble. His first lap speed, 223.342. That is too close to the danger zone. I don't think, unless Boisel picks this up dramatically, I can't see them taking the risk of accepting that low speed.
Former world sports car champion. Lap two. Another 223. In fact, a tenth of a mile an hour slower than his first lap. Gary Gerald in the pit lane.
Wave off area, and Carl Hogan was shaking his head a moment ago. They indicated prior to the start of the run, just as Derek suspected, 225 or better is what they're looking for. I'll be very surprised if they accept this.
There's no need to take it if he's not going to be on the front row, because he can turn around, call the runoff, which he just did, There's Carl Hogan, team owner, co-owner with Bobby Rahal. He can turn the car around, work on it during practice for the rest of this day, and go back in line and hopefully take another run this evening.
1 to 10, charge again.
We'll take a quick timeout and return for more live coverage of the Run for the Pole at Indianapolis. Stay with us.
Back at Indianapolis Motor Speedway, day two of qualifying, actually the completion of day one as pole qualifying continues, and we're here after with a driver, a rookie driver who qualified at Andre Ribeiro. Outstanding effort, 226.495, your four-lap average.
Thank you very much. I think the team, they made a fantastic job. Yesterday we had a problem. I hit the wall with the T car, and today they made a big improvement on the main car, and it's just great.
Let me ask you, lap three, you slowed down about 3 miles an hour. What happened?
I was scared with something like a paper or something that it was on turn two. I went on different lines and I had understeer there.
First Honda ever to qualify for the Indianapolis 500. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I think Honda deserves this. They are doing an incredible job. The engines are getting more and more competitive and they're still surprising a lot of people.
Andre Ribeiro, yesterday, guys, Zampedri put Firestone back at Indy, and today another rookie brings Honda its first starting spot. Bob?
History goes on and times will change. Boy, it's amazing to think about changing your lines at the speeds these guys are going into these corners.
And just changing his line, he said, gave him a scare. Quick update on the Honda engine. This is not the same Honda engine that Rahal had here last year. A totally new design. It was a steel cast iron block last year. It is an aluminium block this year that still is undergoing further development.
And it is sending a scare up and down the pit lane here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. We have more qualifiers in line. We'll be back. Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Yesterday, that umbrella over Raul Boisel's cockpit would have been to keep the rain out. Today, it's to keep the sunshine out as the temperature climbs up towards 80 degrees and the track temperature toward 120. Dr. Jerry Punch is standing by with Teo Fabi.
Teo Fabi, 225.9, the average for four laps. I know you probably had to hope for a little more.
For sure, but the conditions today are not very good for high speed. It's too hot, and we never tested on this condition.
Unfortunately, this is the hottest day of the month. Now, you're going to be in the field. That shouldn't be a question, but I know you would like to have been able to go yesterday.
Yeah, I think we had the car, which was good enough for the front row, but we have to settle for what we got.
Former pole sitter, Teo Fabi.
Well, I said he was taciturn. I once took a long automobile ride with Teo. Took about an hour. I don't think he said a word the whole way, unless asked. But a great racing driver. 14 cars officially qualified. We should reiterate, the idea is to qualify 33 cars, fill up the field by speed by day, and then start the bumping process. Perhaps the third most important day after the race and pole qualifying is bump day. We'll take another quick timeout and return for more live from Indianapolis. Beautiful day for a pit walk here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. There is Robbie Gordon. And when you talk about guys who have a shot at the pole, a lot of eyes have turned to the Valvoline car and one of the brightest young stars in the series. One man comfortably in the field right now is standing by with Gary Gerald.
Well, you talk about a great day for a pit walk. That's exactly what Ari Leyendijk is doing. And at the moment, he's in the middle of the front row. How much a relief to have it out of the way?
Well, I'm real happy for John Menard that both cars are on the front row right now. And it's a relief, but on the other hand, it doesn't matter. I mean, you know, you get up every morning and it's kind of, you do the same thing every day. Like from last Saturday on, you go out and practice. So I possibly would have preferred to do everybody today at one go, because then, you know, we have a level playing field. But it looks like the conditions are a little worse today. But our team had been testing in every condition there was except the conditions we had yesterday, and it kind of caught us out a little bit, but we're still in good shape.
Your teammate, of course, has the provisional pole for the moment. You're alongside. Was it a great disappointment that wasn't just turned the other way around and that you were the provisional pole man?
Well, yes, it was, because I was going for the pole, of course, all week long. We've been setting new records, and Friday evening when I did a four-lap run of 234 and a half average, I knew then I had a real good shot at it, and it was a little bit of a disappointment, but I couldn't get it, and I was real happy for Scott because he has put a lot of work into this Menard V6 program. He's been sticking with it throughout the years, and he definitely deserves this feather in his cap.
Will we see you in the car at any time today starting to work on race setup?
Not today, but tomorrow we'll start again, and I'm looking forward to it because it's a lot of fun the way things are going right now.
Congratulations, Ari.
All right, thank you.
Gentlemen.
That must be a great feeling, being in the middle of the front row. Now, there is Robbie Gordon with the elaborate aerodynamic profile to the helmet. And he should be a very interesting qualifier. Here's a look at the rows as they stand right now. And keep in mind, once again, this is all provisional. Scott Brayton, Ari Lyon-Dyke, and Michael Andretti across the front row, all in Lolas. Menards for the first two cars, and a Ford for Andretti. Then Mauricio Gugelmin of Brazil, Stan Fox, they call the small warrior, USAC regular, Andre Ribeiro, the rookie on the outside of row two. On row three, Roberto Guerrero, former pole sitter for the 500-mile race, Eddie Cheever in A.J. Foyt's primary car, and Teo Fabi, whom we heard from just a few moments ago. Row four, Paul Tracy of Canada, Alessandro Zampedri in a Firestone Shad car, and Brian Herta driving for Chip Ganassi and Joe Montana. Danny Sullivan will be inside row five at the moment. Gilles Deferrin in the middle of that row.
And make no mistake about it, those last two or three rows will change. There will be a big juggling match going on. Now, this man here has the potential to possibly knock Michael Andretti off that front row if these warmer temperatures do not upset that car too much. Robbie Gordon, Brash Gordon, call him anything you want, Mr. Excitement. He is absolutely spectacular on wheels. And he hasn't given up his other passion of off-road racing either, because just last weekend he was out in an off-road event in California. So Robbie Gordon continues to enjoy being off the road. But when he's in an Indy car, particularly after he got that win at Phoenix, he just proves to everybody that the talent has suddenly matured, because he doesn't have the type of incidents that he used to have in years past, and now there's a discipline and a maturity coming about his style that is well matched to his absolute raw talent and ability. When you have that and you have machinery like Derek Walker puts on under you, victories do have a habit of coming your way.
I think it's been a surprise to a lot of observers that Robbie Gordon has been successful as he has been in IndyCars. Cars calling for a lot of intuitive driving, a lot of precision. He grew up racing off-road, as you say. I've seen him drive the wheels off a stock car. I was at Atlanta Motor Speedway for his first test in a Ford Thunderbird, and I mean, he about tore the tires off the thing in cornering. Everybody wondered if he would ever have the finesse. And when he decided he was going to IndyCars, everybody kind of shook their heads a little bit. I don't know about Robbie Gordon in an IndyCar, but he has flourished, and he is one of the bright young stars in IndyCar racing.
Oh, he has a good first lap. It's not quick enough to knock Michael Andretti off the front row, but it's a 228.2. By far and away the fastest car we have seen on the racetrack in these hot and warm conditions. Now, we saw cars earlier get faster as the runs go on. We will keep a almost kisses the concrete wall. Just hold your breath. He puts his hand up and he makes some adjustment inside the cockpit. But watch for his second lap speed. Oh, drops way off, 226.6. Something happened, Robbie Gordon.
Perhaps that's what happens when you get distracted enough to have to reach up to your visor. As mentioned in our practice show last Friday, Dr. Jerry Punch took a look at the Simpson Safety Equipment Company's new qualifying helmets that actually have no movable visors. Streamlined, seamless front with a built-in visor. Robbie Gordon obviously not wearing one today. He's using the traditional flip-up visor with that large fairing in the back to provide aerodynamic support.
Pushes it back up again, almost 228 mile an hour average, 227.998. So Gordon, whatever happened, he's gathered the whole thing up again. He is back up to speed. It's not quick enough to get on the front row, but remember, he said anything over 225 they will be happy with. So all he needs is these last two corners, and he'll be home and dry and in the race.
Right now, his average puts him in the middle of row two.
Takes the checkered flag and doesn't have to hold his breath, but Derek Walker absolutely delighted that Robbie Gordon's safely in the field and Gary Jarrell is down there.
Walking up from the wall is Derek Walker, the car owner for Robbie Gordon. How satisfied are you with this run?
Well, under the conditions, we're pretty happy. We really thought we were going to struggle a lot worse than we did. A lot of people have been going slower, and we really expected the worst, but we thought we'd just give it a try. Glad to get in the field, and it's a good, solid run.
Were you disappointed that you didn't get the opportunity to run yesterday?
Well, in hindsight, yes, because the temperature was obviously much better yesterday than it is today. But, you know, we're in the show. The car's been really consistent. Robbie and the guys have done a great job, so we're happy to get in and get on with it.
So now you concentrate on getting Christian Fittipaldi in the show.
Yep, he's right up next, so we'll give him a try.
Thanks, Derek.
Thank you.
Middle of row two for Robbie Gordon. I'd say that's a solid qualifying effort.
Yes, indeed. And he pulls down and goes to the ceremonial photographic session where the team and driver and car and sponsor and everybody else that wants their picture gets into the limelight. The official photograph is taken, and that's the one that gets sold or gets bought by a lot of people.
This is Christian Fittipaldi, nephew of Emerson, son of Wilson. Another second-generation driver with racing blood in his veins, a graduate of the Formula One ranks.
In fact, Wilson, his dad, has been here all week long, looking over Christian's shoulder, just observing more or less from a distance, because he is still involved. He still races himself in Brazil, but remember, when you've driven Formula One, you have a reasonably good feel for what goes on here. But Christian Fittipaldi, first time ever, he takes an official qualifying run at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
The 2.5 mile oval continues to bake under the sun. Let's get down to the pit lane and Dr. Jerry Punch.
As you watch Christian Fittipaldi attempt his qualifying effort, guys, I was just told a few minutes ago by the Goodyear engineers who are measuring track temperature that they measured just moments ago at 130 degrees. That's the hottest it has been the entire month of May. And when you think about how hot it is, think about the fact that Robbie Gordon just ran 2:28 and change on his first lap, and boy, that is a great lap with that kind of heat.
Well, from here on in, it only gets slower. Everybody knows at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, when you get temperatures that high, you do not look for outright speed. You wait for the sun to sneak down behind the grandstands here on the way into turn two. As soon as the sun disappears, the shadow comes over, the temperature goes down, and the speed suddenly goes up. But Christian Fittipaldi has no option. If he doesn't take this run, he will not become a first-day qualifier. And I'm not sure he's going to be a first-day qualifier, because his first lap speed at 221.1 will not cut the mustard. He will not, I'm sure, take all four laps. Derek Walker surely will make a decision to take him out. Wave the yellow flag.
Slower on lap two, 220.951. His average slipping down towards 221 even. That will not cut it.
Expect the yellow flag for the Brazilian flag. That car color scheme, if you look at it from up high above, it is the Brazilian flag representing his country of Brazil and all the financial backing that he takes from that country to finance this step in his career. Left Formula One on his own decision, wanted to make his career here in IndyCar racing.
And think of all the Brazilian television sets that are on right now watching one of their favorite sons in action here at Indianapolis.
And again, Walker leaves him out there for the experience. Still only 221.6. That is his fastest lap. But Walker is happy to leave him out there for the experience of going through the motions. That was Diane Hall. Diane Hall, the only female engineer in IndyCar racing, working for Raynard, detailing the Walker racing team. And that was also David Cripps, Christian Fittipaldi's engineer. Where's the yellow? There it is. We didn't have to be geniuses to know that yellow was on the way out. It was obvious for everybody. He can smile about it because he has two more runs he can make with that particular car, and Christian Fittipaldi also has another spare car that he can also use as Jacques Villeneuve lines up to make his official run, and Jan Beekhuis is down there.
Well, speaking of Jacques Villeneuve, Derek, we just talked with his team owner, and he said that they're not confident that they have the speed right now. What they have, as you can see, we're being ushered out of the way as they move some of these cars through the tech line. He thinks that right now they'll be lucky to get a 225. Barry Green says we have a push in the car, and now that the temperature has come up, we're not certain we're going to have the kind of speed to make this thing. He says, hey, it's all down to the luck of the draw. We did 230 miles an hour in practice, and now we'll be lucky to make the field. But knowing Jack, he'll stand on it and put it in the show.
No question, Jacques Villeneuve will stand on it. His best lap to date, 230.556 miles per hour.
But then his effort got derailed 2 days ago when Friday evening he had a monster crash coming out of turn two. Just got on the high line on the way into two, got out of the groove, got into the gray, no grip up there, and just pounded the outside wall and brought back his other Ryanair car in a very sorry state. Destroyed the chassis. It is on its way back to England as we speak. A new car is being built up, so Villeneuve is down to one car. I can't imagine, though, this team not having enough speed to be safely in the race. They are too good and too deep in engineering talent, and this car, quite frankly, is too good for them not to be very safely in this field.
And after the performance that Villeneuve turned in last year, running second in the 500-mile race, you see the car shimmying just a little bit. There is a big bump in the middle of that north short chute, as they call it, the stretch between turns three and four.
Down into turn one for the first official lap. You can take two or three warm-up laps here. You tell the starter how many you want. Just about everybody today has been taking two to try and catch these new tires at their absolute perfect optimum heat range to get the most grip you can from them.
Another big hop. Wing waggles just a little bit.
Remember, he already knows. He knows by looking at his digital dashboard what speed he does before we do. We have to wait a couple of seconds, and we do wait and watch the scoring monitor. Whoa! 228.54 miles an hour. Whoa. If he pushes this up just half a mile an hour, he is going faster than Michael Andretti. There is a possibility for a man who said he'd be looking to get in the field or hopes to get in the field that he could end up on the front row of the grid here. Can he go faster? He needs to push it up. He needs to dig a little bit deeper. Maybe get closer to the walls. But here's lap two, just about to finish now. What is the time? What is the speed?
Another 228, in fact, faster. 228.693.
So right now he's inside second row. Michael is safe. Michael is safe on that front row unless Jacques Villeneuve pulls some magic here. And you don't usually make a huge jump if the first two runs are fairly consistent.
It's like a baseball player's batting average or a pitcher's ERA. Once you get late in the effort, late in the season, it's very difficult to change it very much.
So impressive here last season. Finished second. First time ever at the Speedway to come home second. Quite a remarkable feat, and he gets even faster. Woohoo! Almost 229. 228.903. As Tony Sicali looks on, Tony Sicali, his engineer, has such a close friendship and rapport with this young man. Tony Sicali, of course, was a driver himself. Now he's an engineer. Very accomplished engineer. Barry Green, his team owner, his team manager, looks on. They check the watch. Oh, they know he's well clear. Let your breath out. You're safely in the race. You can go ahead now and start thinking about next week's work and race setup. The last lap was slower, 227.4, but it doesn't make any difference. Solidly in the race, and Barry Green delighted, and he's with Gary Gerald.
You have got to be elated with this young man and what he's just pulled off under these conditions.
Kid's fantastic. You know, Gary hit the wall on Friday, on Thursday there, and just come back and run that speed under these conditions is just fantastic. I'm so excited for the players' team, and he's just a great little driver.
I get the feeling that maybe this even has surprised you.
We were a little worried, you know, because we felt if we picked up too much understeer, we'd be in a lot of trouble. And obviously, he handled a little bit slow on the last lap there, but I'm super impressed. I got to get down there and meet him and give him a pat on the back. Thanks, Gary.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Give him an attaboy for us as well. Inside row two, last year's runner-up in the 500-mile race, Jacques Villeneuve, whom Barry Green freely admits he expects to lose to Formula One. The winner in Miami in the season opener this year, Jacques Villeneuve is rapidly becoming a motor racing superstar. We'll be back with more in a moment. Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway with a big crowd on hand for continuing pole day qualifying. A number of cars have pulled out. Jimmy Vassar from Discovery Bay, California, driving for Chip Ganassi and Joe Montana. Yes, that Joe Montana. He is on the racetrack. His first lap, 227.439, as he comes around to complete his second. There you see why Jimmy Vassar is on the track. Some of the Penske cars have pulled out of line.
In fact, a lot of drivers pulled out of line. Hideyoshi Matsuda, one of Dick Simon's cars, pulled out. Fittipaldi pulled out. Marco Greco pulled out. Danny Sullivan had a spare car that he pulled out of line because he was qualified yesterday. Matt Schuster pulled out. Jeff Ward pulled out. Frank Freon pulled out. Bobby Rahal pulled his spare car out, his 9T car. And Alonso Jr., which you saw him there pull out. They have given up all opportunity to be a first lap, a first day qualifier, and Gary Gerald has a report.
Well, yeah, Derek, you're right. Looking at all those cars that pulled out, we had confirmed with the Penske team that they are going to practice more. We've chronicled how they've struggled to get speed, and the plan right now is that they'll take a look at conditions late in the day to see if they'll make a qualifying run. But the thing that I think is of interest, they are not potential pole day qualifiers now. So wherever they fall, they will be a second day qualifier if, in fact, they qualify later yet today. So an interesting development for the team that dominated the month of May 1 year ago.
And they waved it off. They didn't like what they saw. That's Chip Ganassi jumped into the front of the golf cart. So Jimmy Faster, as my three-year-old son Connor knows him as, Jimmy Faster pulls off. Looked pretty good to me. I mean, it was averaging 227.3, so I don't understand what happened there.
227.350. That would have put him inside row three. I saw the checkered flag. Are we sure they waved that off? I think he might have taken that. I think he did. I didn't see a yellow flag.
Yes, he did. He did take it.
227.350 for his four laps. And here comes the former Indy 500 champion, Bobby Rahal.
And that would have been a shock if he did not go ahead and take that. But they're happy with it. It's solidly in the field. Joe Montana was here to watch the proceedings yesterday and also on Friday. He's not here today. He has some promotional activities to go to. But Bobby Rahal is now out, and he's in position seven. Solidly in the field for Jimmy Faster. Bobby Rahal now, having pulled his T car out of line, takes out his favorite car, his race car. He knows that his teammate Raul Bozzella was in trouble earlier. The good thing about having a two-car team, Rahal could go and sap off the information that Bozzella would have learned on his earlier run. But I'll tell you what, he looked awful high coming off turn two there, right out of the black groove and almost into the gray.
While we watch Bobby Rahal, let me ask you a question about the Penske team. They put an awful lot of emphasis on pole position. What's it likely to be doing to their team effort in this month of May to be this far out and the pole simply not an issue?
Well, I, I wouldn't want to use a word embarrassment, but it almost must be an embarrassment for somebody like Roger, who makes the type of financial investment in his team that he does and brings the type of commercial backing that he does to that particular team, that he is not even in contention, not only for the pole, not even contention for the first two or three rows of this grid. I mean, Roger's had his fair share of success here, but I think his troubles here and his strife here this week only goes to show you just how difficult IndyCar racing has become. The depth of talent and the depth of engineering ability and these teams that they're now showing just shows you the change in IndyCar racing. But Carl Hogan does not look too pleased as Bobby Rahal only manages a slow 224.5 miles an hour. That's the danger zone. That is beginning to get into the risk factor, and I don't know whether Rahal will help with the decision or not, because we saw Carl Hogan get on the radio. He talks to Rahal. If this lap is not considerably faster, they may just leave him out for lap three to get some valuable information on setup. But this looks like the danger zone for Rahal. In fact, he goes even slower. So the man who struggled mightily to try and get the Honda into the field last year, now there's a genuine draft beginning to blow down through the walls of his garage area, because this is not fast enough.
Ouch, genuine draft. Bobby Rahal has certainly seen his share of troubles here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in recent years, failing to qualify altogether 2 years ago, having to lease a couple of Roger Penske's cars to get into the race last year.
So this is lap three. Right after this, the decision gets made. Let's have a look at the speed. No, it's only average again. 224.3.
Easily the slowest. If he were to take it, among the qualified cars, we have five full rows and two cars on row six. Not where Bobby Rahal, as a former champion, intends to start his next Indianapolis 500.
He can wave it off and take two more attempts. He can go to his backup car that he also ran very well and very fast this year. We're going to watch for Carl Hogan. Yellow flag, almost no option. Why take the risk?
Well, we've seen some surprisingly quick times. We've seen some wave-offs in the 223, 224 mile-an-hour range. Let's hear what one of the hot guys is willing to accept. Here's Jan Beekes.
Well, Jerry Punch had a chance to talk with Scott Goodyear earlier, but now you've been able to see what some of these other guys can run. With your teammate running that quick, do you still think you have a legitimate chance up there at the front?
Well, I think the overall speeds are down. We just saw Rahal pass on a 224. Encouraged to see Robbie Gordon run a 227, 228 area. It's hotter. I think the speeds are a little slower. We did some changes in our car this morning, and we put them on Andres before he qualified. It helped him, bumped him from 221 to 226. We hope that maybe we can find 3 or 4 miles an hour, too.
Yeah, so if those changes are there, you may actually have the opportunity to take a front row spot here. You could be the last legitimate pole contender here.
Well, we took the changes we learned, put them on Andres, and he liked it. And we ran 26 this morning. We've gone a little bit further, and hopefully we find a couple more miles per hour.
Okay, let's get down to Jerry Punch. Thank you.
And Jacques Villeneuve has climbed out of the car. And Jacques, outstanding effort in qualifying. I know you would like to have run quicker, but considering the heat, 228.397, quickest of the day and fourth quickest overall.
Well, we're very happy with that lap time in the heat. We didn't think we could run as fast in the heat. The track is pretty slippery today, but you know, the team made a great effort during the whole month so far on working the car. Actually, it's the same people as last year, and last year we had a terrific car, and this year the car is still incredible. And it's actually even faster in the heat.
You're very modest giving the crew all the credit, but your comeback from an incident earlier in the week with the other car, that took quite a bit of courage to go out there and push the button, knowing you might have a bit of an understeer.
Well, we crashed 2 days ago, went straight in the wall, and I didn't want to have any understeer today. And actually, the car was almost too well balanced, and in the last two laps, the rear was sliding in corner two, so I lifted a little bit in the last lap just to be safe.
What'd you learn last year as a runner-up that you can put to work this year, maybe to move up a spot in the 500?
Well, we'll work hard on that. It will be very difficult to be in the top three anyway. And of course, we'll try like anybody else to win it. I know that the team
makes good calls on strategy during the race, Barry Green, and I know the car is going to be strong as well, so now I'll just have to do my job right.
Incredible talent, guys. Jacques Villeneuve, he is 24 years old and already a runner-up in the Indy 500.
All right, thank you, Dr. Jerry. Down on the racetrack, Scott Pruett, who has logged by far the most miles on Firestone tires in his Lola Ford Cosworth. First lap, excuse me, Derek, 227.767.
And a good lap for the return of the legend here. It's also the return to prominence of Scott Pruett, such a talent whose career almost got derailed in 1990 with a horrific crash while testing for True Sports, run by Steve Horn, who runs the Honda team here. But a huge crash that has left Scott Pruett feeling the effects every day. He has metal braces keeping his vertebrae together in his neck and his back, and also a steel rod in his back. Jim McGee looks on a second lap above 227 miles an hour, so the legend continues to return in style. This man is the leader of the IndyCar World Series as we speak.
Back in 1990, when I last covered these qualifications for the Indy 500, Scott Pruett was my color commentator, and he had to be wheeled up to our announced position in a wheelchair as he recovered from those injuries you spoke about. But his spirit never flagged. Not for a minute did Scott Pruett ever doubt that he would get back into a racing car.
Takes the white flag, and his speed is still very consistent. All his laps are above 227 miles an hour. The last one, 227.1. So Scott Pruett absolutely safely in this field. And the consistency these tires have shown is quite remarkable. They're a conservative tire company at the moment. We have never heard of a Firestone tire wearing out. We've never heard of a blister on a Firestone tire. Al Spire, who's the racing manager, could hardly believe the results in the opening races at IndyCar. He could hardly have hoped to come here in a better situation than to lead the championship. As Steve Newey, the engineer responsible for the setup on that car, has a grin and a smile in his face because his driver, Scott Pruett, safely in the field, all his laps above 227 miles an hour.
Down to Gary Gerald in the pits.
Jim McGee, you've got to be pleased. This whole effort coming together so nicely, these conditions today, and solidly over 227.
Yeah, Scott's doing a great job, and I'll tell you, the tires are incredible. Firestone's done a hell of a job with the tires, and we're really pleased with the whole group. You know, Pat and Steve Newey and, you know, everybody, and, you know, we're just looking forward to a good race.
All right, we look forward to it with you. I know they want you down there. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you.
18 cars now safely qualified into the field. For the moment, everything remains provisional. We'll be back live to Indianapolis. Mention that he's out there first or go right to Jerry. Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where the run for the pole continues with a $100,000 check and a $35,000 van going to the winner, along with a trophy from Tiffany's Jewelers of New York. Just a part of the plunder here at Indianapolis. Let's get down to Dr. Jerry Punch in the pit lane.
And we are standing by with Jimmy Vassar. And Jimmy, although you would have liked to have run yesterday, you certainly can't be disappointed with what happened today.
No, you can never be disappointed when you get into the Indy 500. It's such a big race and a thrill. And you know, I had aspirations for the first row or maybe the first couple of rows. And but you know, it's the tradition. Part of the tradition here is the way they have qualifying, and it's, you know, really unfortunate we had drawn a late number. But you know, the Target STP crew did a great job with the car, and I think we're gonna have a real good race car. And yeah, I'd just like to thank Chip Ganassi for giving me a shot to drive for his team and to help prove myself.
You certainly can't what if, but yesterday in practice you were well over 230, close to 231, and you got to wonder, thinking about the front row, what would have happened had you had an early number.
Yeah, I think, you know, I don't know if we could have beaten the Menards, but we sure had a closer shot at them with the numbers that they ran. They weren't as quick as they had been going, and but it's all about the race here, so we'll just get to work on making a nice, solid race car. You can win this thing from just about anywhere in the field, and I think we're going to be starting on the third row, so that's close enough, too.
Close enough. Jimmy Vassar at well over 227.3 miles per hour.
Thank you, Jerry. Now on the racetrack, Hiro Matsushita, his first three laps, 225.7, 226.1, and his fastest of all, 228.050.
Wow, that is a surprise. That 228 in conditions that we know are hot and slippery. The Panasonic-backed car, this is the Arciero racing team, and awesome Al Arciero himself is here to watch the proceedings. And Gary Gerrell has a comment.
Derek, as he comes down to take the checkered flag, Bob Sprow on the left, Gordon Kopik, the engineer, they elate. Sprow came into this team in the middle of the week. The next day, they jumped 4 miles an hour in speed. He's a man who knows this racetrack well. They've put together a great combination. There's a lot of emotion here, and deservedly so, for what Hero has just accomplished.
No question about it, Gary. He is on the outside of row three. A spectacular accomplishment for Hiro Matsushita of Japan.
And that is impressive. That is impressive. The sheer raw speed that he displayed on lap three there is the type of speed that anybody in line right now would love to have.
19 cars qualified. A margin of 6.167 miles an hour separate them. We'll be back. Live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, right into your living rooms comes Scott Goodyear. His first lap, 230.882 miles an hour.
Absolutely astounding that he could drag speed like that from this car in conditions that we know are very hot and very slippery. What a difference a year makes for Scott Goodyear. What a struggle he had last year trying to qualify at 218 miles an hour when he was scared, and now he runs above. Look how close he goes to the wall. Now he's above 230 miles an hour. Can he take the pole? Can he take it?
Tom Carnegie on the PA mic here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for the 50th year is telling the crowd he's on it, and Scott Goodyear is.
And Scott Goodyear is on his way to the front row of the grid, and Steve Horn can hardly hold his breath long enough. His heartbeat is absolutely pounding out of his chest. The Honda engine, 14,000 plus revs. They won't tell me how much plus means, but it revs more than 14,000 revs here, and Scott Goodyear is spectacular.
Well, with all their Formula One experience, even though this engine was put together by American Honda, Honda knows how to make high revving engines. 230.657 miles an hour on his third lap, dropping about a tenth of a mile an hour with each lap. Right now, 230.7, his average, will put him on the outside of the front row.
What a run for Tasman Motorsports. LCI Telecommunications have backed this team since its inception. Scott Goodyear only joined this team and came to run with them just a few short weeks ago. What a difference he has made. He was brought in for his experience and his ability, particularly here at Indianapolis, and he takes the checkered flag, and will he be on the front row? Yes, he is. We don't know the time, but we know from Steve Horn's reaction. Oh, he is. He's on the front row of the grid. And Gary Gerrell, what is it like down there? Oh, he got away from us. Almost tried to grab a hold of Steve Horn. In his excitement, he didn't even want to talk. I bet he couldn't talk.
Oh, he was so nervous before. You could tell a twitch in his voice. He's probably speechless, literally, right now. Third fastest. And in these conditions, Scott Goodyear has just sent a shockwave down the pit lane. What will that car do when the track is truly fast?
Steve Horn, incredibly, has managed to put Honda engines and Firestone tires on the front row of the grid here at Indianapolis.
So we now have 21 cars in the field, and as Scott Goodyear makes his way into the pit lane, he follows the golf cart carrying his team owner, and at about 15 miles an hour in that cart, Steve Horn was standing up, pumping his fist at the crowd. Look at the crew.
Congratulations, boys. You deserve every accolade that you can take from this. That was an absolutely spectacular run, and Steve Horn and his wife Christine are outside our booth, absolutely in tears, arm in arm together. What a superb run.
Now Adrian Fernandez is on the racetrack. Oh, what an act to follow. Cars in the field.
the fastest, 231.604 miles an hour. The slowest, 225.437. A little over 6 mile an hour difference front to back. The widest margin in the 33 car field was back in 1928, 28.8 miles an hour. The closest field back in 1953, separated by just 3.1 miles per hour.
Fernandez now the fastest speed he has had all month long here, 228.5. And look at the celebration. It continues here as Scott Goodyear takes congratulations from everybody. His wife Leslie moves in for a kiss and a hug. Oh, what a great day for Scott Goodyear. What a difference a year makes. Just think of the struggle last year. Jerry punches down there.
And Scotty, we're standing by Scott Goodyear getting his gloves off and getting that helmet off as he tries to get a deep breath. Everyone just jumping around the car down here in anticipation as he pulls that helmet off. You probably will hear quite a roar from this crowd. Scott Goodyear, incredible effort here in the heat of the day.
Well, I'll tell you what, the guys did a great job on the Tasman team. We've been together for just about a week, and Steve Horn runs a great operation. The Honda power plant just worked flawlessly, and the tires, Firestone tires, what grip they gave me today. I mean, it's just wonderful, and my hat's off to all the guys in the team. They deserve this.
Incredible story for the Honda motor. A year ago, it doesn't make the field. This year, you put it on the front row. That's got to be exciting for you.
Well, it is. I mean, we came here with a mandate for the pole, and, you know, it's hot today. It's another 40 degrees track temperature. We would have loved Ron Judge today. I don't know if he would have caught the Menard guys, but we got bumped off the front row a couple of years ago when we were with Walker Racing, and I still remember that, and I didn't want that to happen.
Scott Goodyear, who finished runner-up here a few years ago in the Indy 500, a big smile today with a qualifying effort.
Well, remember back in 1969 when Mario Andretti won the race, the 500-mile race, that is, and Andrew Granatelli came sprinting down and threw him into a headlock. I tell you, you saw just about the same thing there from Steve Horn. Adrian Fernandez waves off his run. My goodness.
And the emotion of the moment is what is so great about Indianapolis. And we caught it there because you could hear it in Scott Goodyear's voice. And it is just great to see that emotion because the hard work this team has put in to try and dream first of success with IndyCar racing, it is great to see it.
Down to Gary Gerrell.
Bob, I'm just thinking down here. You look at that front row right now, not bad for three guys that are once-a-year race car drivers. Brayton is not a regular. Leyendyke's not a regular. Goodyear didn't have a ride this year. And they've got the front row, and I don't think anybody's going to knock them out of there.
Team Social Security, all on the front row of the grid, all in line looking for contracts, unemployed after this next weekend or two weekends.
The fun continues. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. It has been an astonishing day so far. Scott Goodyear put in an electrifying performance to take a spot on the outside of the front row. Meanwhile, Roger Penske, the Indy Meister, has pulled his cars out of line. There will be no pole for a Penske car this year, but there is plenty of drama still to come. We'll be back later today at 4 p.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. Pacific, to take you right to the end of qualifications, and that includes second day qualifying as well. So there's plenty of drama, plenty of great stories to tell on a perfect day here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. There you see one of the Penske cars. That one belongs to Al Unser Jr., the defending champion. He may still have a story to tell us later today. We'll be back. Coming up next here on ESPN, some great golf action as NFL stars of the past and present go up against the senior PGA Tour players in the senior PGA Cadillac NFL Golf Classic. Live final round coverage from Upper Montclair Country Club in Clifton, New Jersey, coming your way next on ESPN. Back at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, we are under a yellow flag. We have completed the run for the pole, and so our front row is now set. We are set to begin second day qualifying here on the second day of qualifying for the Indy 500. Let's get down to the pit lane where Gary Gerrell is standing by.
Well, Bob, this very distinctive bubble shape over the engine
tells you that this is a Menard. We've got two Menards in the front row, the pole in the middle of the front row already. Here's a new 95 Lola ready to go, and the crew is getting it ready, and the young man who's going to get a chance to drive it is Buddy Lazier. And Buddy, I know you have got to be excited, because never before have you had a chance to sit down and get quality time in a quality race car.
Well, that's right. You know, I'm very excited. It's a good race car. It's a current. Be the first time I've been in a current chassis, so that's obviously exciting. Our goals are not to go out and be, you know, the quickest car on the racetrack. We just want to get the car in the race and then have some time to work with it, obviously, next week.
Yeah, there's no plan to try to qualify today. You want to get time, work your way up. And
well, no, actually, our plan is to try to attempt a qualification run today, but we're not looking for the ultimate amount of speed, obviously, because the front row has already been established. We're a second-day qualifier, so we'd like to, if it's possible, to get the car in the race and then work on our race setups next
week. Is that enough time for you to feel comfortable and try to qualify?
Well, I don't know. We'll see. It's going to be interesting for sure.
Well, I'm very surprised, but we're anxious for the opportunity for you, and we know it's going to be an interesting afternoon. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Gentlemen?
All right, thank you, Gary. The top 20 are now set. Pretty soon we'll begin the run for the 21st position in the 33-car field. We'll be back live to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in just a moment.
Rachel Rose before the break.
Back at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where the track temperature is touching 138 degrees, which explains why no one is out there right now. But we expect qualifying to continue shortly. It will be second day qualifying. Here are the top 20 as they presently stand for the Indy 500. Brayton Lyandike and Scott Goodyear with that dramatic run at the end of first round qualifying to take the outside of the front row. Row two will be Michael Andretti and Alola Cosworth, and the Reynard Cosworth of Jacques Villeneuve, last year's runner-up, and Mauricio Guglielmin of Brazil will be outside row two. Row three, Robbie Gordon and his Reynard Cosworth, and the Alola Cosworth of Scott Pruett, and the Reynard Cosworth of Jimmy Vassar, with a great run in the conditions today. Hiro Matsushita will be inside row four, Stan Fox next to him, and Andre Ribeiro on the outside. Row five, Roberto Guerrero, Eddie Cheever, and Teo Fabi. Row six will be Paul Tracy, well back in the field. A bit of a surprise there. Alessandro Zampedri will be in the middle, and Brian Herta on the outside of row six. And on row seven, Danny Sullivan and Gilles Deferrin. The next round of qualifiers can be no higher than 21st, at least until we get to bump day next Sunday. We'll be back to wrap things up from Indianapolis. Stay with us. That wraps up our qualifying of the road to the pole here at Indianapolis, conveniently timed with the beginning of second day qualifying. Derek Daly?
And we've had something unusual almost every day and something spectacular. It was Scott Goodyear today. There must be an irony in the fact that